Thank you, Zilda Zoom. Okay, welcome to Experts at Work. And this session is for members of all three of our networks, as you know. Recording this session, as the nice lady just said, but not, of course, the breakout rooms. And a big welcome to Rebecca Wallace, who's Director of People and ESG at Rico UK, and Monica Orlinova, who's PR and Social Media Manager there as well. So what's interesting about this, of course, is that in HR, we often talk about collaborations across functions, and probably the one we consider most of all, I think, is probably with marketing. So hearing how this has worked in practice for Rebecca and Monica, it's going to be really interesting, very instructive. Just to let you know, timings, Rebecca and Monica will be sharing some thoughts for the first third or so. Excuse me a second. Sorry. Then we'll have a breakout room session for about 15 minutes where we're going to ask you what more do you think you could be doing with your marketing team? You might be doing lots already. You might not. There's always more to do, I guess. So that will be the question to consider for about 15 minutes, as I say, and finishing with some reactions from everyone on the call and some discussion over the possible solutions approaches, with a hard finish at 1 o'clock. So send us questions and suggestions via chat throughout. And if you put yourself on mute for now, if you would, that'd be much appreciated. Rebecca and Monica, over to you, and I'll get the slide deck up now.
Brilliant. Good morning. Good morning to everyone, and thank you for joining us. I have to say, I am so excited to share this with you, probably more than I should be, actually. But fundamentally, as Richard said, I'm the Director for People and ESG in Rico. And one of the things that we are very proud of is a project that, we worked with from a HR perspective with marketing over the past year and is live now. And that's what we're going to talk you through. And in particular, I want to share with you the work we've done, particularly how that worked on that collaborative basis. And hopefully with you'll be able to take away some thoughts. So the project is sort of really reflective of our people strategy. So we're very much from our newest strategy. We are a people first approach as a company. And one thing that we were guilty of, I think, in the past is doing lots and lots of things which were both people and actually ESG related. But we did so many things that no one really knew what we did. Our internal people, our external people, our potential candidates and our customers. And we had such a good story to tell that we didn't have a way of telling it. So externally and probably internally, we weren't represented as well as I feel we could and should have been. And marketing, Monica and one of her internal comms colleague, having been aware of all the things we were doing, because they worked with us on a lot of the things, came and said, you know, we'd really love to look at our careers page, effectively our EVP. We're already doing a little bit of work around employee value proposition, which Monica will cover off. And what we're going to do is going to take you through the presentation in a slightly odd order in some ways, because we're going to talk about Monica will kick off with what we actually, the beginning and the challenge we had, then show actually the end result where we got to. And then as the third part of the presentation, talk about how we got there in terms of how we worked together. And what we're going to talk to you about is effectively how we collaborated to improve the talent and attraction offering, as well as our internal retention, our customer interface through our corporate website. So next slide, please. And I will pass you over to Monica.
Thanks, Rebecca, and good afternoon, everyone. So about, I guess, about 18 months ago, we really noticed that we have a bit of a challenge with our careers pages. And I guess this was the case beforehand as well, but it's probably become more, it grew in significance post-pandemic. And you can see the old careers pages here on this slide. Obviously, they're no longer live, but we just wanted to kind of show you, just to give you a bit of an overview. The user journey was very broken. There were so many click-throughs. It was very confusing for people. It was very copy-heavy, and a lot of corporate language was used. The information was there, but it didn't come together as a concise storytelling. There were no real people stories, no proof points. Some of the information was outdated, and it just didn't look credible. It just didn't tell that story in the right way. The creative looked a bit disjointed as well. We looked at the data, and we noticed that in April last year, for example, we had about 30,000 people coming to the overall Rico site, and only 14, that's 1/4 people, were coming to search for a job, which obviously is a tiny, tiny percentage. So we knew something wasn't working. And we really kind of faced three main challenges with this. I guess the first and the most important one was around not being able to fill positions. And I guess that was you know, that was a challenge for the industry overall. But we really noticed that we were not getting high quality candidates through the door. Secondly, obviously the external voice and positioning was very limited. We really wanted to obviously tell our story as an employer of choice and really showcase the great work that the HR team were doing. But it just, as I explained on this slide, it just wasn't working. We wanted to create a hub where anyone can go to and really get a clear view of what we stand for as a company. And it just wasn't there. And thirdly, we also wanted to continue improving our employee engagement. So we wanted our employees to really become our brand advocates externally and really instill that sense of pride and give them an opportunity to share their experiences externally. So these were the three main challenges that we were facing. And I guess from the marketing perspective, traditionally, our focus has always been on customer marketing and sales enablement. But in my role as a PR manager, obviously, my focus has been kind of on brand and reputation as it relates to our target customer audience. But increasingly, I've been noticing that it's just simply not enough anymore. We can't just be talking about our business message without really explaining how that feeds into the wider ESG agenda. And actually trying to kind of link the two in a meaningful and powerful message. So next slide, please. So that was the start, and now we're going to show you what those pages look like at the moment. So if we could just click through Richard onto the page.
Bear with me a sec.
So this is what the pages look like at the moment. And we decide instead of kind of trying to work with the existing pages and trying to, you know, fix things here and there, we just decided to start from scratch and really kind of go from zero, really. And the first step in that was to do a lot of external research into what candidates were looking for in 2022. And again, everyone on this call will know much more about this than I do, but obviously, people were increasingly asking questions around, you know, flexible working, mental health and well-being, about identity, about, you know, carbon cutting, growth and development. All these questions were important to people. So that was the external research. Internally, we obviously were aware of a lot of the great work that we do, but we really wanted to dig deeper and really understand the key areas where we felt that Rico is doing better than our competitors within the sector. And then combining that external view and the internal view, we came up with these six unique selling points that you can see here on the page. So those are inclusive recruitment, flexible first working, mental health and well-being, diversity and inclusivity, growth and development, and our planet and communities. If you just scroll down, Richard, a little bit, I would just like to show you that I guess our challenge in marketing with kind of at Rico in general is that Rico is a very well-known brand, but we're mostly known as a print manufacturer, which is no longer the case. So we obviously still do print, but we're very much a digital services company now. So our portfolio includes areas like cybersecurity, cloud and infrastructure, you know, automation, and all these great things that we obviously want to talk to our customers about. But through this, we also want to talk to potential candidates as well, because, you know, we want them to feel excited and want them to be part of that innovation within Rico. So this is where that, you know, it's a good opportunity to do that with some of the content there. And we also have, you know, a bit more information about our values, our pledges as well. But as you can see, the copy is very minimal. Everything is kind of video-based, asset-based, kind of done in a creative way, which hopefully is more engaging. From the creative perspective, we worked closely with our in-house designer to make sure that the creative kind of reflects the internal positioning, which is all about kind of vibrant working. So we use a lot of kind of those vibrant colors, but externally, obviously, we have corporate brand guidelines, which are a bit more strict, and the two don't necessarily talk to each other. So our designer did a great job to kind of bring them together in creative that you can see throughout these pages. So for anyone who's coming either from external or internal, it doesn't look disjointed. So I guess the next step, once we identified the six USPs, was really to kind of start telling those individual stories in a concise, creative, kind of very personable way. So if you could just click through on mental health and well-being, just as an example to show you very quickly. Obviously, there's a bit of an overview there, but as soon as you kind of read that, you can see most of the content is just people stories. And we work with the HR team to kind of really unearth those stories from our people. David there, which you just saw, is a brilliant brand advocate for us. He's so passionate about mental health and LGBTQ+. So we feature him quite a lot because he's brilliant. And then you can see the well-being champions just underneath. This is Amy, by the way. So she's part of the team. She's responsible for internal communication. So she's on annual leave now, but at least you can see her on the page here. And for example, Jeff's story, the reason he became a well-being champion at Rico is because he lost a close friend to suicide. So he's obviously very passionate about kind of helping others. And I just feel, or we felt that, you know, having a very short kind of informal video where he talks about his story is so much more powerful than us trying to kind of write two paragraphs on why we do what we do. So this is kind of the approach that we have taken with this. If you scroll down, Richard, a little bit, this is another example of content here with financial well-being, which is a very important part of our well-being strategy. Again, instead of kind of trying to just write about it, we took a different approach. We've treated it as a bit of a Q&A between Rebecca and Tony, who's our reward and insights manager. So again, trying to kind of almost like a journalistic approach to this. So just kind of trying to come up with creative ways of telling those stories in a way that's a bit more interesting. And then towards the bottom, you can see a link to our insights, which is our thought leadership platform. Again, kind of increasingly covering topics like menopause, mental health, disability. We've got a great article there from Rebecca herself. So this is kind of how we approached this project from the content perspective. We can probably go back now to the deck, Richard.
Coming up. Everyone see that okay?
Not yet.
I know, big problem. Let's try that.
Yep, that's good.
Perfect.
We could go to the next slide, please. Oh, no, sorry, the activation. That's it. I think it's just a bit slow. Brilliant. So I guess now we're moving on to the bit in the middle bit where we're going to talk about how we got there in a little bit. But just to cover off the activation, I guess it's no good just to simply create these what we think are beautiful pages and just let them sit there. It's really important that obviously there's a communication plan to go with it to really activate it and keep telling everyone about it. And this is just a bit of an overview on how we approach that. So obviously we started internally, and this is where obviously Amy kind of led in her role as internal comms manager. So internally we took a phased approach. We started just to make sure that the different stakeholder groups are brought into this at the right stage, and that we really get a buy-in from everyone. So obviously Rebecca has been involved from the very beginning, but the first step was to present to the board to make sure that they're happy with what we're saying. Secondly, we presented to the wider HR team. And what I think is most important, we talk to the employee forum and also the different affinity groups that we have within Rico UK. I think that was really important because obviously a lot of the things that we're saying are very close to their hearts. So we wanted to make sure that we're saying it in a way that they're comfortable with and are on board, because if that was disjointed, then, you know, it would break down at some point, I think. Next one was presentation to the senior leaders. So again, making sure that those hiring managers are very, very aware of kind of what we're doing, And the last step was really just to tell everyone about it. And we chose to do that on one of our town halls, which is a virtual event where all Rico UK employees are invited. And obviously before, people that were presenting on this call were already kind of involved with this. So it just, that communication just worked really nicely that way. And in addition to that, obviously we have regular kind of internal communications where we utilize our newsletters, you know, weekly roundups, blogs, etc., to make sure that we continue to push that message in front of the people. There's obviously a multitude of touch points that people come across when they're applying for a job at Rico, starting on, you know, with a job ad or a recruitment site or a LinkedIn post, and then all the way through that job interview process, then onboarding, and et cetera, et cetera. So we obviously wanted to make sure that the story we're telling on these pages is reflected on these across these touch points as well. And to be honest, that's still an ongoing process. We've done some bits, but others are still happening. Obviously, it's quite a big one. So, but we it's important to get this right to make sure that that you know that person has a really kind of unified view of Rico. And then externally, which is very much kind of my area, obviously content is probably the most obvious one. So we have our Insights page, which is essentially our thought leadership platform, which traditionally has been used mostly for, you know, business message, kind of talking about things like cybersecurity, IT infrastructure, etc. But increasingly, we've been working with the various SMEs and affinity groups and executive sponsors to create blogs on topics like, you know, how does hybrid working affect mental health, menopause support, inclusion, etc., etc. And I think where we're seeing the most success is when we try to link, when we link the business message and this people message all in one content, because I think that's what makes, that's what interests people essentially. So you can see an example there. We talk a lot about digital maturity as a company, and we've created a blog on how digital maturity actually can help elevate organizations' DE and I strategies. And how, you know, a digitally mature organization actually is a, you know, is a big part of that of being of that attraction to potential candidates to join the company, but actually how that works vice versa as well. So the more diverse people you've got with different backgrounds and different skills, they then drive the digital maturity for the organization. So I thought that was a kind of an interesting angle when we kind of combined the two previously separate agendas into one. Next one is PR, which is obviously kind of what I do mostly. So this was about just making sure that we incorporate and build that people's message into our media strategy and kind of building pitches and identifying opportunities around key dates. And I've included some examples there on the screen of the coverage we've had. So you can see the spread of kind of financial well-being, menopause, pride, various different topics that we managed to get coverage on, which has been quite successful, I think. Social media, this is not going to come as a surprise to anyone, but obviously people, content always works best on socials, where you get, it doesn't have to be kind of, you know, high production videos and pictures, as long as it's kind of credible and kind of put together in a human language, that's what people are going to kind of engage with most. So it's important to kind of find the right balance between the business and the people message as well. And lastly, I just included a bit of information on other. So this is really about kind of working with all areas of the business to try to identify opportunities where we can talk about the EVP. So for example, recently we've so we usually enter this, I think, I can't remember the name of the award now, but we kind of enter those business categories kind of every year. And this year we decided to enter the ESG one and we talked about financial well-being. And it's just because, you know, at this point, I feel quite comfortable talking about these topics because I've been working with Rebecca's team so closely obviously everything still goes through the team to make sure it's right, but I'm kind of 90% there in terms of the message and what I think we should be writing about. So that just makes life a bit easier for all of us. And I included spokespeople as well, because we do have an executive sponsorship program in place where every board member is an executive sponsor for a different strand of diversity and inclusion. So when it comes to our spokespeople strategy in PR, we make sure that we really bring to life that that element of D&I in their strategies, making sure we talk about that in their bios, which we're just in the process of updating, etc., etc. So these are just examples, but obviously there's so much more. But I guess the key with all these areas, I would say, is integration, which is our favorite word over here. We use it quite a lot, but it's very important, because otherwise that message is just not going to cut through in the right way. And that's integration between obviously marketing and HR team, but also, you know, within HR team and within marketing, just making sure that we kind of talking about these things in a very aligned way. So next slide, please, Richard. On this slide, we just wanted to kind of quickly check through some of the results. So the first 2 points, Rebecca, you could probably touch on.
Absolutely. So thank you. And hopefully that's given you a flavour of how we work. And one thing, just to back up what Monica's saying, I think one thing that we're really, really confident about now is our internal messaging and our external messaging are completely aligned. And particularly because we are a business to business operation, you know, increasingly with ESG's prominence now, for example, including the D&I and the people aspects of that, you know, I literally am talking to customers in sales scenarios now because they want to know all about this. But the real win for me was, I'll talk in a second about the applications and stuff, was our employees can now actively be our advocates, so they can talk about RICO and actually know the things we do and how we differentiate from other organizations. So just a quick touch, because it wouldn't be right if we didn't tell you, has it been successful? Employee engagement, we measure using Gallup 12, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with. Whilst we can't obviously have that direct correlation between exactly what we've done with the website and everything else, certainly our results year on year from the year before this was done to the most recent results have gone up significantly across every question. So our employees are feeling much more engaged with the organization, and that could be because they know so much more about all the good things we do. It's not just kept in pockets. Also, we do an inclusion survey, and we got way more responses to that, and again every single area we went up. And interestingly, the areas which score highest, albeit I couldn't say it was statistically validly higher, are interestingly, when Monica spoke about our affinity groups, it is our minority groups. They feel that overall they are treated, you know, very, very well indeed. The other areas is obviously the obvious one, number of job applications. I think our talent acquisition lead could not be in a happier place with what she is now working with. And just to give you a feel for where our actual applicants come from, 84% of our applicants come through these pages we're just talking about. And in terms of feedback, the reason they've come through, exactly what Monica was saying, our USPs, what people search for, what they're looking for, is what we've used as the sort of the keywords and the search words in the actual website. So we have a massive internal recruitment, which obviously in terms of savings, I could put some numbers against. I know it's about for us, it's into, yeah, seven figure every year. We get savings through doing internal recruitment. So if you need a business case for your board, there is one in its own right. And when we look at numbers of applications, there's always a spike in January. We know that. But if you look year on year, we were going to put the numbers on, but it was kind of meaningless without the talk track. They've gone up. They go up month on month on month. And also they are significantly higher than the same period last year. So those are the results, and, you know, very, very positive feedback. The other bit Monica touched on is where we've aligned what we're saying here with everything we do in terms of the candidate journey, even the job adverts, they'll be online. They have all the links in, so people can quickly get back into see this website, to see all the wonderful stuff we do in the one place. Over to you again, Monica. Thank you.
Thank you. So we've seen improved traffic and engagement on these career pages, but as I'm sure many of you will know, there's been a new cookie policy, which means that when you go on any kind of website, you're given an option to kind of not to be tracked, which is great for people, but not so good for businesses because it's quite difficult to now make kind of meaningful comparisons between kind of pre-launch date and after the launch date. But it's still useful for us in terms of kind of seeing what the trends are and also what pages are most popular and which ones are not. And we also work with our digital team to make sure we use other tools available to us. So there's a software called Hotjar, which allows you to kind of look at like the specific areas of the page and where people spend most of their time, which for us actually has been super useful because we can see, for example, that over 50% of people actually scroll all the way down to the bottom of the page, which is amazing. That's probably the best we get for any of our pages. And it's great for us because at the bottom is where we have our CTA button to kind of go and search for a job. So, you know, we can see that that this is working very well. But equally, if there are any areas where we know we need to improve, obviously we kind of address those as a priority. Social media engagement, I already talked about. Obviously, it's the sort of content that that, you know, works best. So it's about finding that right balance between kind of the business and the people message. And media coverage, I already showed you some examples, but I would say maybe about 10% of our coverage last year has been to do with kind of the people message and people content. So it's a significant chunk of our of our coverage overall. We can go on the next slide, Richard, please. And this is the last slide from us, promise. So this is where I guess this is like the key takeaway from this session, and it's more about kind of how we got there and our top tips, if anyone's interested. So the first one, I guess, and it's as with any other campaign or project, it's about the team. So making sure that you have the right people on board with the right skill sets. We work very closely with people from Rebecca's team, all the SMEs, you know, responsible for different areas of well-being, diversity and inclusion, benefits, corporate responsibility, and we have kind of bi-weekly calls with them, with all of them individually. From marketing team, I already mentioned quite a few of my colleagues, but we work with digital team to make sure everything is SEO optimized, to make sure that user journey works, to help us kind of make those changes because the process is quite difficult, or not difficult, but complicated because everything needs to go through our shared service center. So they really help us to kind of do that in the right way and in the right process. And with, as with any project, I guess strong ownership is needed. And I would say it's probably good to have someone who's reasonably neutral to make sure that, you know, if you have too many people who try to push maybe their own agendas a bit more, it's just useful to have someone who's a bit more, I guess, objective and who you can trust to tell that story really well because it's an important story to tell. Then building the business case, obviously getting a buy-in from the senior stakeholders is absolutely vital for getting this sort of project off the ground. Obviously, Rebecca did that for us. And I would say it's very important to have the data. That might seem obvious, but obviously where you can back it up with data, and that's where your marketing team can help you, obviously. That's important. We try to approach this in a very agile way. So we try to work with agile methodology in marketing and increasingly across other areas of the business, which I guess the main example of that would be that instead of waiting for perfect product, we were aiming for the minimal viable, really. So making sure, you know, those pages are up and running as soon as everyone was reasonably comfortable with them. And then really kind of looking at the data and obviously continuing working with other people to make sure we keep on improving. So that kind of relates to the last point on the slide where I said the work never ends. And it really is true because we went live in October 2022 and we've already gone through three major updates, which is probably more than we do for any other pages, to be honest. So we look at the data on a monthly basis, and we then use the data to create basically quarterly updates. So again, this is where it's important we work with the team to understand, you know, what new stories we should be talking about, what the news are there, you know, any areas that we should be focusing on more, and it's just an ongoing process. And I guess just the previous, I was just going to quickly jump on the authenticity. For me, that's the most important thing, because there's no point in trying to claim something that you can't back up. Obviously, consumers, candidates, everyone is very savvy, and everyone can see through the corporate fluff, if I can use that that language. And it only takes one mishap to kind of break the trust. So it's very important that you kind of approach this in a very authentic and honest manner. And I think it's also okay to say, you know, we know we're not perfect. You know, we know we need to improve on things, but we acknowledge that and we're on a journey. Again, instead of trying to claim something that we're not. And obviously that authenticity and that honest approach will then help you to build that foundation for employee advocacy in the future. And the integration and alignment I already touched on, but it's obviously working closely with everyone and making sure we're singing from the same hymn sheet.
Thanks ever so much, Monica and Rebecca. That was great. So there's lots to think about there. I just want to pop us into some breakout rooms so we can have a reflect on that. And great, thanks for coming back. I just wanted to ask a question of the speakers that was put in the chat, which I loved. So Ali from Virgin Media 02 said, and I quote, any skills or reflection, Monica and Rebecca, that you didn't have in the team that would have been useful? And while they're just thinking over that one, which I think is terrific, after your discussions in the breakout rooms, Jane Casey, Jane also asked in the chat about employee referrals, people that have found got employee referrals up. So put your hands up if you've got any ideas on employee referrals, and then we'll go into the wider discussion of HR and marketing. But just to turn first to Rebecca and Monica, that great question from Ali, any skills and reflection that you could have done with?
I will go first, and then Monica. This is really a Monica answer, not me. So what I will say is, we, in terms of, if you just looked at my division, every single skill we didn't have was why we went to marketing, from the technical, from the positioning, from, you know, how you'd think about it, from how you'd make it all relevant, and all the rest of it. So my people, you know, this Monica did most of the speaking on this, because this was a marketing project but with a massive HR benefit. So I think my people just literally had to find people and get them to tell their stories. So Monica will be able to answer from her perspective.
So we're quite a big team in marketing, kind of relatively speaking. So we did have a lot of the skills in-house, but I should have mentioned that we actually work with our agencies as well. And we used to have a really good copywriter in our digital agency that we work with very closely. And she actually copywrote most of those pages. So yes, this is where we knew, you know, we needed a good copywriter. So we went to our agency. So it was still mostly within our retainer. But I guess, and we just had a conversation during the breakout room that, you know, some teams are much smaller and they don't necessarily have those skills. So I guess that's where the best thing would be to kind of approach an agency or an external consultants to kind of help you with that, obviously budget permitting. But I think it's a worthwhile investment to get it right.
Thanks both. And just flipping back to Ali, who asked the question, skills that you've noticed, Ali, that people consistently perhaps miss out on, as it were, within HR and marketing, or things that you've noticed that actually have benefited each other?
One of the conversations that we had, and I think we're really lucky in a scaled organisation to actually have a lot of the skills that we need actually on this topic. I think one of the interesting dynamics that we faced into recently is the different maybe lenses that the marketing team would have versus the people function. So In the spirit of transparency, one of the current sorts of live conversations for us is on our LinkedIn pages, our marketing team have put in details of a sponsorship of Love Island onto our site. And actually, we know that a lot of our employees aren't supportive of that because they don't think it actually fits with our values, our inclusion agenda, our mental well-being agenda, and of course our marketing team are coming at it more from a kind of product lens, and our recruitment team would come at it of course from a people and culture lens. So that's been that's actually a sort of live one that we're facing at the moment. So we have less of a skills issue and more one of alignment of, you know, the outside and the inside on product, people, culture, and it really resonated with me, that point around authenticity earlier.
Okay, nice, that makes a lot of sense, thanks Ellie. And that leads us on very nicely to, in your groups, excuse me, what struck you from the discussions in terms of either how you could do more with marketing or perhaps what you've done that's worked well? Nancy, hello.
Hello. Some of the stuff was just actually plain obvious. Things like that it gave me a swift kick up the backside to sort of do something around. We do such amazing stuff that we just don't talk about. We talk about it maybe a little bit internally, but not on our external careers page. You know, things like parental coaching, because we're quite small, which is a really expensive thing that we do. Mm. To help transition our colleagues through, you know, a monumental life change. We give little milestone gifts. We have wellness champions now. We don't talk about it on the careers page. It's given me a lot of bullet points, things to go talk about with our marketing team. And I think as a starting point, to remind our marketing team exactly what it is we do offer our colleagues, and then to get their view on how we can make it sing.
Nice, Nancy. Well, that's a lovely way of putting it. I love that. Seeing a lot of nods there from Monica. Is that similar experience that you had when you started?
It was the parental coaching that did it for me. I think that's brilliant. You should definitely talk about it.
Thanks. I do. I wish I'd had it when I was going through that change. And it's available to fathers, you know, expected mothers, carers of people, just any monumental life transition.
Thanks. And other experiences of working between HR and marketing, love to hear them. Also, just to remind you about Jane's query about employee referrals, where you've seen that work well.
Richard, it's been a really good session, and I've learned a lot. But one thing that we got chatting about was actually not just the relationship between HR and marketing to benefit your external brand, but also talk about internal brand as well. Where I'm at the minute, we've got quite a lot of challenges around, you know, we've acquired businesses and things like that. It all seems a bit disjointed. So I'm working with marketing to try and align some of that and create a sense of culture and unity. And so people have their sense of place within the organization. So I think it can be both external and internal, that relationship.
Nice. I like that. I like the sense of place is a nice way of putting it as well. And Rebecca, can I just turn to you on that point? Do you feel that you've created more of a sense of place as a result of this campaign?
Oh, absolutely 100%. And one thing I should mention actually is this is something I was probably talking to marketing. When you talk about the skills in the role, maybe a reflection on perspectives of people in the team, because I was talking to marketing saying you only, early in social media days, you only put stuff out about products, no one's that interested, put stuff out about people, and started getting that message going, and it was a change in our internal comms manager. Monica came back from maternity leave as our external comms manager effectively, who go, yeah, we get this. So actually there isn't, I can probably see some nods around here, I can't see everyone's face, but you have to get people who see where you know the future is, really. And as we all know, regardless of what industry, and it's all about the people and the markets and the recruitment market. I think we've got more of a business case now for building that, but no, definitely the internal brand bit was kind of my starting point, I'll be honest. I'm not, you know, but it obviously the knock-on was the external bit. Yeah, people love, we get some amazing results.
Nice, thanks Rebecca. And Julia, welcome, nice to see you.
Sorry about that. I was just having difficulty unmuting. Just because you were asking about any other examples, just one of the, and thank you. Great, really, really interesting presentation and lovely to see the change in the website. You can just see the difference. One of the organisations I used to work for, I think, have taken a really nice approach to working alongside marketing and communications. They've started, instead of thinking about using Instagram and TikTok to sort of just promote new jobs and things, what they've done is taken the opportunity to celebrate every event like Pancake Day, Valentine's Day, Easter, whatever, and use it as an opportunity to showcase the organization. And it's a bit fun, it's a bit light touch, a bit lighthearted, but you know, they'll walk around and give everyone a rose on Valentine's Day or give them pancakes on Pancakes Day. And subtly what it does is it gives insight, you know, opens it up, it's transparent, it's visible, people can see inside the organization what the buildings look like, what the different roles do. And it's just, I thought it was just a really clever, really fun way to open up. You know, a lot of organizations are quite closed, and that was the conversation we were having. People make assumptions. I think Janice was saying about the civil service, that it's all sort of oak furniture and dark corridors, and actually it's light and open plan and airy, and just putting it out there and giving people the opportunity to see it is what marketing can be really, really good at doing. So
examples as well. Excellent. Thanks ever so much, Julia. Well, Rebecca and Monica, thank you ever so much for doing this. We're going to bring it to a close so that people can get to the next 1 p.m. meeting, which many of you will have. Jane's query on employer referrals, please do share in the WhatsApp group if you've got anything that can help with that. Thank you ever so much. Well, it's been, today's the longest day, so happy longest day. Is that a thing? It's probably not a thing. No, it's probably
sure too long.
Isn't it? Happy Jaffa Cake Day. Every day's happy Jaffa Cake Day this year. Lots of events coming up, so we'll see you soon. Thank you ever so much for coming. Thank you.
Thank you for listening. Thank you. Thanks, everyone. Thanks Richard.
Thanks all.
Bye-bye. Bye.